on Facebook, also on YouTube, and of course, we have a whole bunch of people on here. Just a little bit of housekeeping. We did just start a crush group last week. And there is still room for one more person if anybody was interested in on the fence. Easy for you to start now and get a recording and keep going. It is a little bit after, we'll wait maybe one more minute. It's 2:01 in the east right now and 11 in on the west coast. I know we have mountain time on here because I saw Samantha Daly. We also have central time. Bear with me here. There's Ed Brem. I'm just cruising through on my iPad. It's a little harder to see all the screens. So this week, I'm really, really excited because we have Christina Longo coming in live from Boston Metro. Christina, where did you move? What is it called now?
I'm in Needham, Mass.
She's in Needham, but she was a city girl forever. Yeah. So that's what happens. That's what happens when you have babies.
They dragged me out here.
That's exactly right. Yeah. And Christina is with Guaranteed Rate. And I'm going to let her tell you in a minute just how long she's been in the business. I think we've known each other for, Christina, you want to I think it's 11 years, if you can imagine that. Or maybe 12. A long time. And Christina is a JOEL person. She is a agent partner person. That is how her business is built. Of course, I'm sure she refinanced every loan that she did, which I would expect. You don't want someone else to do that, but probably never taking her eye off the ball, with the exception of two little boys on purchase business. And I know this, I've met some of Christina's partners in her market. I know how loyal they are to her. So very, very exciting to have her on today. Christina, tell me, when did you get in the business? How long have you been around? God,
I think I've been doing this 17 years at this point, but I started off as an assistant. So, I mean, I guess I've been originating really for 15, but
I was that's a long time.
Yeah.
That's a long time.
Makes me makes me look old. Makes me
I was in a room. I forget where I was. I started traveling again in May, and I was in a room and I was asking people how long they've been in the business. I was actually in a room where there was not one 80/20 LIDOC person. Not one. I was what is going on here? Yeah. There's not one person that was originating in 06, 07 that saw that. And they're no. I mean, we've read about it, but it was amazing. I was like, wow. I'm kind of old, but I did get in the business when I was 7. So you know how it is. All right. So Christina, the first question I'd like to ask, because it's so topical, even though it's changing a little bit, I want to hear a little bit about your market, because your market is notorious for these little towns. Those of you that are not familiar with Boston Metro, I don't want to say it's weird, but it's hinky because it's got all these little towns and they have their own school system and they have their own police and their own, these little towns. Well, some of them are big and some of them are little. And there was scenarios where you had four listings in the whole town and everything was either there were 50 contracts being written, right? Or they were going pocket listings, right? You had to know the right people. So the first question I've been asking everyone, all the loan officers we've had on here, is regarding inventory. Are there things that you're doing as an originator or your team is doing through this market to provide better service for your agent partners who, besides being a shrink and a therapist, which I'm sure you are, to the agents who, I love when people go, agents are overpaid. I'm like, you have no idea. They're probably making $2 an hour right now because they're having to write so many contracts, what types of things are you doing, qualifying under multiple programs to being more available, things like that. Tell us about, and is your market also, tell us a little bit, is your market starting to just a tiny bit lighten up a little bit? Is there more inventory coming on?
Yeah, I mean, right now, it's just so difficult. It's difficult for everyone just being in this industry. I know that everybody thinks it's so easy. It's like, you're a loan originator. Oh, you must have it easy. It's like, our job is harder than it's ever been right now, right? I have to be best friends with everyone. I got to be best friends with my clients.
I'm doing well. How are you?
I got to be best friends with attorneys. And it's like, everybody's got to get along, right? Because if somebody doesn't get along, it's like things can spark out of control very quickly. There's a ton of pocket listings happening. There's all those different kinds of funky transactions, which is so frustrating for these clients that are putting in these deals and these offers for 15, 20 different properties, and they keep losing. So, you know, it's just more of like differentiating yourself from, you know, a different loan officer to try and make sure that A, your buyer stays with you from the first offer to offer 20. You have to constantly drip on them, constantly be in touch with them, constantly follow up with them, just to kind of stay in touch. And the realtors that I'm finding are relying on us to do that for them, because they know my tight relationships that I have with my realtors. They know that I'm going to feed them back any information. So they're using me as a crutch to keep these clients on the straight and narrow, right? And make sure that they don't weave, you know, and if they are weaving, yeah.
I wanted to ask you, so what are a couple of things you do besides the call, the text, the emailing? Is there anything else you're doing with consistency? I just wrote down borrower stays with you. That's a big concept. And when I'm doing training and talking to loan officers about that, I'm amazed that they work so hard to get the referral and then the borrower floats away. You know, they work so hard to get them in and then they're gone. And I call that just looking at pull through. And I know you have good pull through, meaning once you get them, they're not leaving Longo. I mean, unless they're, you know, something weird happens, they're not leaving. Is there anything little weird, special, anything that you guys do besides the normal grind, ground and pound of staying in touch?
For the agents or the borrowers?
Borrowers to start borrowers. With.
Okay. So, well, at Guaranteed Rate 2, I feel like this is a huge plus for us, where we have this Red Arrow Express, which is a program that when I take a full application up front, when I speak with the client and I go through all the rigmaroles, we want to lock and load them, right? Like, we want them to stay with us forever. So we immediately convince them that they need to get pre-approved. And during that pre-approval process, we then need to submit their file into underwriting. Okay. So we do a full underwrite right off the bat up front, so that they ultimately know that they need me to get their offer accepted, right? So we need to make sure that we do a credit pull. We review their documents, all of their documents. We need
Hold on. Everyone hear that? You guys know this is a JOEL person. All of their documents. Okay. Christina, I can't tell you how many times I've seen people using Red Arrow or Guaranteed Rate, and they have all these loans that are pre-approved and they have like 900 conditions on them. I'm like, by the way, that's not a pre-approved borrower.
No good.
So I just want to clarify that even though Christina has Red Arrow, if you're working in a company where you don't have Red Arrow, which is a ton of people on here, you can still do what Christina did before that. And that is review all their docs and say you're pre-approved.
But review your documents.
The key is all the docs. Go ahead. Keep going. Sorry.
I mean, every agent calls me, right? So like if somebody's making an offer, one of your clients is making an offer and the agent calls you, I'm not going to lie. And I'll tell my customer right off the bat, like, if you don't want to do Red Arrow, that's fine, but I need all of your documents because I'm not putting my name on a pre-approval letter. That's not justified. So I'm not willing to do that for you. So if you want to get pre-approved and you want to be a serious buyer and you want to have a good relationship with the agent and myself, since we work as a team, my suggestion is let's do all the steps. This is what we go through, and then we will validate your worthiness of buying this home.
And Christina, just a couple of things. She said team. So what I'm assuming is your agents completely have your back on this. So when the borrowers turn around and call and complain, which they all do, if I would have gone over here, they would have asked me for nothing. And Christina, right? Your agents say, stop. I told you that was going to happen. And yes, get her everything. Is that a true statement?
Totally. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Big difference. Everybody's, we have to be on the same page, especially in a market like this. We have to be on the same page with the agent. Even the attorney, you want almost like once they get involved, you want everybody on the same page.
Okay. Awesome.
But so, yeah. Yeah.
Christina, just give everyone some just clarity. How many purchase units did you do last year? I know you had a kid in there somewhere. It's a lot, right?
Yeah.
Well, how many do you normally close a month?
What do we do? 400 units? I don't know. Something. Okay. Yeah.
So you're easily closing 25 purchase units a month right now. Easily, right? About 20.
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to give everyone some clarity because we didn't talk about that because this is not someone who's closing five loans. We are going, oh, she has time. No. And she does it with a small, very efficient hit crew of the Longo ladies, correct? Are there any men in there yet or no?
There's no men, no. And we're trying. We're trying real hard, but we have work. So we're just kind of going with it, you know? I think the guys are scared. They're scared to come on board with us. So it's okay. That's totally fine.
Samantha Daly's laughing right now. She's with CMG in Denver. She's cracking up at that. Okay. And you also said the realtors are really relying on you to hold their people. I call it be sticky, you know, make sure their people stick to you. I know you're calling. Do you call if you have someone that's been through Red Arrow? Let's say you have a pre-approval. So supplies to anyone that has a pre-approval. How often are you in touch with them until they get under contract? You or someone on your team?
We do a drip campaign, but we constantly, probably every other week, will follow up with them. Have you seen anything, whether it be email or phone call? I know email is not the best, but sometimes just a way to touch them. But we'll do a follow-up. We have a spreadsheet that we follow up with all of these people. And until they buy a house, they're not escaping us.
Buy or die.
Yeah. You're in it. You're in it to win it. This is a relationship that we have formed here. And I'm not letting you go until you let him go.
Tell people lead follow-up systems. I call it a BIC system. You know, all sales is based on sit down in front of somebody and tell them how great you are. And then, of course, ask for business. That's sales. I tell people, if you actually follow up on the referrals you get from your agent partners, you don't have to sell anything to anyone. They'll tell other people in your office, yeah, I work with Christina and my business doubled. And the only reason it doubled is because she actually follows up with people. So I close more. Now, as far as listing agent goes, I've heard a lot of loan officers on here in the past 8 weeks, 10 weeks, say that their volume was staying consistent based on the fact that they were literally selling the deals through with the listing agent. Are you making those calls as well when somebody goes under, well, they're not under contract yet, they write a contract. Are you making those calls as well to explain the whole deal?
100%. I mean, if I don't, then I'm at the bottom of the pack, you know, so it's a disservice to my buyer. So yeah, I mean, the second the offer goes in, I get a ping either from the agent or I get whatever the contact is for the listing agent. I call them, I introduce myself if they don't know who I am. And I just let them know, hey, here's where we're at. We did either the Red Arrow Express, they're fully underwritten, they're ready to go. We just need an appraisal, give me 2 weeks to close. Or if they're just regular pre-approved, you know, I give them all the details. And it's better to be forthcoming with that information than to have them pick up the phone and call me. I feel like it's huge in this market and they appreciate it. They're like, oh wow, they want to get the deal done. This isn't just somebody who's just checking the box and saying like, oh, it's just another deal.
And loan officers are hearing this all the time, but yet they're still not doing it. Somebody made a comment. I think Sean Gaudreau's on here right now. He's a guaranteed rate loan officer. He's at Chris Parker's group. And he said, Joel, you know, there'll be like 20 offers and like two loan officers called. Two. Not like 20, like two. Yeah. It's incredible that they're too lazy to call because, oh, you know, I'm too busy or whatever. So Christina, go ahead.
It's funny because a lot of times you do call, and I shouldn't say a lot, but sometimes when you call the listing agent, they're annoyed by your call because they got 20 deals. They're trying to put together. They don't know how to work an Excel spreadsheet and they're trying to get these offers presented to their seller. Right. And they're annoyed that I'm calling. And I'm like, listen, all I'm trying to do is get you paid. Yeah, everyone needs to make this transaction happen. So let's just make it work. And then they change their tune when they're like, oh, she's actually trying to help me here. So I would 100% suggest being proactive and make the phone call. It cannot hurt you at all.
And also everybody, you know, that means your relationship with your agent partners is deep and to the point where you are being alerted immediately. Christina said that real quick, where I get pinged and then I know and I can make the call. If you don't know or you know 5 hours later or a day later, it's a lot worse than knowing immediately. So Christina, before I always tell everyone, I've gotten a lot of feedback on this, that people love keeping these calls to a half hour. And I know you do so much cool stuff with your clients, your borrowers, and with your agent partners. Do you mind just sharing a couple, like maybe your top two, top three of borrower type of things? And also, you know, because it's so huge and you see the best loan officers across the country do this as far as your community involvement stuff. And I know you've changed communities. Well, not really, but you moved yourself out. But I know that's still your home-based community. I'd love for you to share a little bit about the stuff you do there, because I know that's been clearly a part of your success, meaning being visual.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I found that like even starting out in the business as long ago as I did, it's all personal touch, right? And that's how I learned it. It's like, be you, surround yourself with people that are like you or have the same interests and the you know, there's gotta be a common denominator between you and whatever the referral partner does. I just find that, even with the borrowers, like when you have your initial conversation with them about the loan, you know, make it personal. Like, do you have kids? Like, where are you going? Like, what area are you looking at? You know, talk about the schools, like talk about things of interest to your buyers, because that's how you're building your rapport and establishing a relationship and making them feel comfortable. This is like a very overwhelming experience that they're going through, right? They're buying a home. It's this biggest purchase of their life. And right.
Top three most stressful things in life.
Oh, yeah.
Death of a family member, divorce, buying or selling a home. I mean, it's a known fact, yeah. Massive stress.
So if you just give them like a little bit of like your normalcy, not just a loan originator, not just somebody who's trying to get a deal closed. If you just say like, hey, like, how are you? Oh, you have kids? Oh, so don't I. Or if you don't have kids, it's fine. It's like, oh, you like to go to, you know, Europe and oh, I've traveled there. You know, just find something and that establishes the relationship. And then as you can transaction.
Josh, can you mute that person? Sorry, Christina, I don't
that's
know.
That's okay. As you continue through the transaction, you know, you constantly drip on those common items that you have within your buyer. If you send them a little note, you know, throughout the transaction, they're not expecting it. At the end of my transactions, like post-closing, I create a cookie gift basket, and I've done this for years, and it's been such a huge success. But I create a send over a huge cookie basket to my buyers. Congratulations on your new home. And on the cookies are screenshot pictures of their home, right? So now they have this really beautiful cookie basket. Not that they're like ready to dive into, they don't need cookies at that point. But at this point, they're like, oh my God, this is so nice. It's like an ornament. Like we put it in the freezer, we can do whatever we want with it. But it's just another personal touch. And whether you send it to their office, which I typically do, so that they share that with their coworkers over, you know, in the cubicle next to them. Oh, my loan officer sent me this or whatnot. But it's those small little personal things that provide referrals.
So just to be just a little tactical for a minute, is that like an iced picture? So it's an edible, picture. Of their house. Like,
yeah, but I can't even tell you how many people say that they're like, I'm freezing it, I'm never eating it, or, you know, whatever. And if they have kids or whatever the, you know, conversation was like with them, if they have their dog is their favorite thing, then you find a picture of their dog off of Instagram and you make a picture of their dog on the cookie and they think you're their best friend. And then you continue to be their therapist for the rest of 10 years or whatever. But
what else do you do for staying in touch? What else? Any other fun little things? Even how about during the process? Do you do anything interesting while they're in process? I know I just heard you said it real quickly, and all the JOEL people on here are dying. They're like, oh my God, another note, because they know how I am with handwritten notes. I saw you said drop them a little note, you know. It's interesting thought. And I think it's probably pretty awesome. It probably mellows them out too, especially if they're stressed, just to literally see a handwritten note from you. Is it? Yeah. Now it's not from any of your staff that are helping you work on the files. It's from you.
It's from me. Everything's signed from me. Everything's branded to my name. Although my staff is amazing and they do so much for me, it's all like from Christina. It's okay. Christina's the face and the name and the brand of what we do. So we're all on the same page. But like if somebody just has a baby, you know, you order stuff like Guaranteed Rate has so many tchotchkes and swag and like have so much of it in your office, because in an instant, like they'll mention something on the phone call, I'll write it down. And then I have one of my assistants, you know, will write a card and like put in like a onesie that says something about a baby, you know, something. So it's just like that personal touch. And we do a lot of that.
Now, did you all hear she said, write that down? I was in a group meeting, Christina, last week with a team, and I was telling people how if I hear a dog bark when I was originating loans, I'd hear a dog bark. I'd go, oh, what kind of dog is that? And they'd say, oh, you know, a Labrador Retriever. And I would write down Labrador Retriever. And I would say, what is the dog's name? And they'd say, oh, Charlie. And then the next time I talked to them, I'd be like, why don't I hear Charlie barking? They'd be like, oh my God. And I didn't lose any loans, believe me. There was no
it
more.
It freaks them out. They're like, oh wow, this person actually cares, you know? So it's
But I wrote it down. Exactly. You do. Because you can't.
Oh, I write everything down.
How about agents? Cool stuff with agents. I know we just came from COVID.
They just want me to close their deals, period. They close my deals. But they love, I always do every season or every holiday, I'm either making either a gift basket or just something to pop by their office. We just made for 4th of July, we just did like fireworks and s'mores and like just this big giant thing. And I make we make 45 of them. Maybe we hit some people, maybe we don't, but we drop those off. For Halloween, we do wine mummies. We wrap up bottles of wine and we just do all kinds of fun stuff and they love it. You know, and it's funny because some people might not necessarily work with me right off the bat, but if somebody has a wine mummy on their desk, they want one too. And sometimes they throw you a deal, you know, a deal or two, but those are the things that we do.
How has COVID, do you think, and then I want to ask you about the market a little bit, but how has COVID, do you think, changed your business and your agent partner's business going forward, meaning things that are that are always going to stay changed?
COVID has definitely changed us for the good and bad. I wouldn't say, I mean, I miss going out and having, you know, drinks or bowling or doing, I miss all of those events. And we're slowly getting back into that. We just did Cycle Boat Boston and we were out and I had to book two boats because the response back from people that wanted to, there's only a capacity, you know, it's a capacity limit. So we had to book two boats, but like people are ready and raring to go. Like they want to get back into it. I feel like everybody wants, you know, everybody wants to get back into their regular routine. I think that.
Do you think the agents want to go back to their offices or do you think they'll be way more home-based agents now?
I think that, I mean, a lot of the agents that I already work with are pretty much home-based anyways, but they still have to go into the office to pick up their checks or do whatever. So I don't think there'll be a huge change from where we're at. I mean, people want to escape their kids at home and have to get out and go to the office. It's like, it's real life, you know? So nobody wants to be stuck in their home. So
where do you see the market? I want to just share my opinion. Tell me if you agree or disagree or you want to add to it. So I think right now we're having COVID summer. And what I mean by that is everyone that's being cooped up is like, yeah, I'm going somewhere. You know, either I'm going to the beach or I'm going here, or I'm going there or whatever. I'm going somewhere, anywhere, Disney World, whatever, I'm out. And, you know, because of that, the market sort of just swooped down just a little bit, okay? But the fact that I know where I am is pretty conservative, like where you are, you know, but they've already said, hey, the kids are going back to school 5 days a week. So there's no more like rent a beach house in the middle of September and not worried about your kid not to be in school. You can't do that anymore. So now we're back to normal. I think the fall will be an epic purchase market because I think we're seeing more inventory come on. People are going to come back from their sort of post-COVID hangover. They're hopefully there's no Delta variant crap going on, but they're going to come back and be like, okay, let's go. It's rock and roll time. I still want to move. And what I'm hearing from other agents across the country is they're definitely seeing inventory coming on, creeping on. What do you think about that? And do you think prices will continue to go up or do you think they're going to stable, go down, keep going up? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I know they're not going down. So I can almost guarantee that they're not going down. There's not in our markets. I mean, maybe they'll stabilize. Who knows, you know, how we see the correction happen. But I don't think I think we're still booming and we're still going to continue to crank and values are going to continue to go up and mortgage rates are just going to stay low for at least another couple years. We're at all time lows. I mean, these interest rates are ridiculous, right? So we're not seeing a major change. We might flatten on prices depending upon what market we're in, but no, I totally agree with your outlook there on what's happening with people. And you could, yeah, up and take your kid to Florida for a couple months and they're on their Zoom class. That's not happening anymore. And I think that just being a mom and my kids going to school, like I want normalcy, right? Like we need normalcy. We need the constant, like, the soccer practice, the school, you know, you need to have that. And people want to be back in that world. People are buying.
Now, I have a question I wanted to ask you specifically because where you do a ton of your business, I'm sure you're probably strategically moving it out a little bit too. But who's buying condos right now downtown? Because everyone wanted like more space. You know what I mean? So who are those buyers now? Because I know you have tons of them. Is it empty nesters? Oh, empty nesters. It's the other end. They're going back in.
They're going back in.
They don't need all the space. They can pop their house for a massive profit and they're going back in. I hadn't even thought
empty nesters. Okay. And it's like, I feel like the people that exited the city as fast as they did were the ones that were looking for like the 3 to 5 year plan before they had kids, right? So they're just skipping that plan. They were the ones that were like, oh, we got a couple more years before school becomes an issue. And then we're getting involved with school lottery. They just skipped right over that. And they just bypassed that and they went right into the suburbs. But empty nesters are coming back into the city. Investors are still out there. You know, we don't know how that will go, but I feel like it's mostly empty nesters and people that don't want to have children.
Now have the condos in Boston, have they leveled off? Or are they still, if it's listed for 800, is it going for 875? Is it still that type of market?
Yeah, it's still like that. There, nothing's changed. I mean, the only ones that are sitting are the ones that if something doesn't go within that weekend, there's a problem.
You know? Well, there's two reasons a house doesn't sell. Price too high or a dog, right?
Right. Just, yeah. And you it's like a mentality thing because people are like, oh my God, something's wrong with it. It's like nothing's wrong with the house. It's either, like I said, it's mispriced or there's an issue, you know? Right. So and that's why it's not selling. But condo, and I feel like they're still priced a little bit where they need to be. And there people are still bidding $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 over it. People still want to be in the city.
Yeah.
I have a lot of friends that are still in the city that are like refusing to come to the suburbs.
With people in Manhattan, with people in, well, California is different because everyone's just angry there. But even, you know, in a lot of large cities, I'm hearing the same thing with condos. In DC, the condo market's on fire. Right. You know, right. It's the same type of price point as where you are. It's crazy. And right. I was just wondering, like, who's buying them? Because the whole COVID story was, oh my God, I'm stuck in my house with two kids homeschooling, getting yelled at for a sandwich, and I got kicked off of Zoom. You know what I mean? I need more space. And they're just running out of the city for more space. But the condo market's not slowing down.
I had people calling me asking me if I would sell. So it's not like people aren't buying condos. I sold my condo in like a hot minute. So it was not difficult. Yeah. When we decided to hightail it out of there.
All right. Awesome. Christina, if people want to ask you a question, what's the best way to find you? Is it Facebook? Do you want just an email? What's the best
email's way? Best. I mean, email Christina@rate.com. It's pretty easy. I'm on social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. It's my full name. I'm not Longo. Well, I'm Christina Longo Tretheway. So if you can't find me under Longo, that's why.
You just watched This Old House. That's her husband on there.
Just
you
watch,
can find him
yeah.
on there.
You can find him on there.
That's exactly right. Well, thank you so much. There's a bazillion other things we could have covered. I definitely wanted to hit the things you're doing with your people. And I loved some of the stuff you said. It's just the ground and pound grinding. No really bells and whistles because you don't need them. Is borrower stays with you. I wrote that down, you know, and I'll just leave everyone with this one thought real quick. I talk this with executives all the time about pull through, about, you know, credit pulls. For me, a credit pull is an app. Okay, so if someone goes in your automated system, whatever it is, you run their credit, it's an app. Okay, so you pull credit on 100 people for the month. And 15 of those people I call can't do's, okay? Meaning they have a credit score too low for a program you have, or they're not gonna buy within 6 months. So I call those people can't do's. So now we're down to 85 people. Okay, so you pulled credit on 85 people that can buy and wanna buy, okay? And you closed 25 loans. So where'd the other 60 loans go? Like literally, where are they? You know, and people just go, you know, and you just look at you do that pull through percentage and you're like, I'll tell you where they went. You didn't follow up with them. Or what's John Minglardi, follow through or whatever he used to say, Christine, all the time. But you know, you didn't follow up with them. I don't mean you, but as a loan officer, you didn't follow up effectively at all. And they're gone. When you go back and you call those people, they settled with someone else. And you spent all this time and a lot of times money to get the people and you let them go. And I love the way you put it, borrower stays with you. I know that's very simple, but it's a sticky concept that a lot of loan officers don't get. I mean, sometimes it's interesting if they do go and it's with a realtor you've been trying to meet and they weren't referred by an agent, you won't let them go. but for the most part, you don't want anyone going anywhere. And, you know, it's one of the reasons, everyone, why Christina is so successful is she's focused on that. She's done the hard work to get them in. And it's more than just that loan closing and getting paid on it. It's performing for your partners, you know, because part two to that was realtor relying on her to keep the people in. like literally to duct tape them to a wall until they close and not let them out. And I don't know, I said all this really quick, everyone. Christina's partners support her on how hard she's going at them up front for docs. She doesn't not gonna have the problem where the borrowers are screaming, oh, if I go to over here, they're not gonna ask me for anything. Because her partner's gonna go, I don't care. That's the wrong way to do it. There's a reason I sent you to Christina. Okay, so just do it. And Christina, that's one of the biggest pushbacks I get from loan officers. Well, the agents just tell them whatever they want to hear. And I'm like, well, you don't have a deep enough relationship with your agent partner because they should have your back 100% because you're the one that's going to get them paid.
In the first phone call, when you do get off the phone with the customer, if the customer thinks that they can, you know, they don't need to send whatever, is to the agent or the referral partner to say, hey, listen, heads up, this is what we need and this is why we need it. Yep. Well, I'll support that and they stand by you. And that's where the relationship is because that's who's driving the business, not the, you know, not the client. So.
Oh, you guys heard that before? Exactly. That's beautiful. Hey, in the chat, everyone, is Christina's email. It's just Christina@rate.com. John Minglardi's texting me, Christina, but I'm not going to look because then who knows? He's lurking. He's lurking on here somewhere. But everyone, thank you so much for being with us for, I think it's a little bit over a half hour today. Thank you, Christina Longo, Guaranteed Rate in Boston Metro or Needham now, right?
Yeah, I'll say Boston.
In the suburbs. Everyone, thank you so much, Christina. Thank you for your time. And we'll see you all next Monday, 2 p.m. Eastern. Thank you.
Bye, guys. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.